HarperCollins presents Dead Men Tell Tales, The Memoir of a Police Surgeon by Dr. B. Umadathan. Translated from the Malayalam by Priya K. Nair. Read by Lavin Kumar. Foreword by K.P. Somarajan, IPS DGP Vigilance, Thiruvananthapuram, 1st March 2010. Oru Police Surgeonte Ormakkurippukal, written by my friend, well-wisher and guide, Dr. B. Umadathan, is an autobiography that tells us about some experiences in his professional life. We see the efforts made by a forensic surgeon to unravel the mysterious deaths of unfortunate people who lost their lives under suspicious circumstances. Dr. Umadathan never hesitated to dispel suspicions and reveal the culprit, even if the shadow of suspicion fell on an investigating officer or the doctor who had conducted the post-mortem. When you read this book, you will realize that he was a man with a pure heart. Even when he was wrongly accused because someone held a grudge against him, or due to some misunderstanding, he never gave up his steadfast faith in the scientific principles of forensic science. I think Dr. Umadathan chose forensic medicine because he wanted to be a teacher like his father. He was also greatly influenced by the dynamic Dr. Kanthaswamy, who was the first forensic surgeon in Kerala. These memoirs capture the reader's attention and create an aura of suspense. The book has been written in a simple style and can be read in a single sitting, as though it is a detective story. It is important to remember that Dr. Umadathan's aptitude for teaching helped many police officers learn the basic lessons of forensic science. He wrote many books on the principles of the subject for officers, and the texts were well received and appreciated. It is a known fact that when there was court action against Crime Branch Inspector General G. Jairam Padikkal in the Rajan case, the glory of the department dimmed. The investigation officers became disheartened and the investigations lost vigor. It was when the crime branch was going through this bleak period that Dr. Umadathan became the medico-legal advisor to the police department in July 1987, and we became colleagues. He held this post for 7 years and in 1998 retired as the director of medical education in Kerala. Till he left for Mauritius to become the principal of a medical college there, he discharged his duties in both capacities. It must be specially mentioned that he was able to find vital clues in complex cases and, by keen observation and scientific analysis of evidence, was able to give an expert opinion. I would like to underline the fact that Dr. Umadathan was the most efficient medico-legal advisor in the police department. I don't see Dr. Umadathan as a mere forensic expert. He was a medical detective who cooperated with the investigating officers, and he was someone who was often keener than the officers to visit the scene of crime. He would collect minute evidence and give expert advice, which would expedite the investigation. The Kerala police was able to utilize his vast knowledge of forensic medicine. I have long felt that Dr. Umadathan was best suited for the profession of a detective. It was in 1991-92 when I was Deputy Inspector General at the Crime Branch headquarters that I was able to collaborate with him in several investigations. We discussed many cases that could not be solved by the Crime Branch and scrutinized the evidence. The case of the pastor's wife mentioned in Chapter 13 is one such case. It was Dr. Umadathan's intuition that told him that the pastor might have got the cyanide with which he killed his wife from the jeweler's shop, which was right next to his Siddha medical store. It was again his intuition that told him that aviation fuel might have been used to kill the doctor, in a case that he talks about in chapter 37. Like a magician, he used the technique of superimposition to recreate the face of a decomposed or charred body. During a time when videos were not available, he recreated a dead person's face using photography and medical principles to establish their identity. Many cases were solved thanks to this. His efforts helped establish several identities, like Chacko's identity in the Sukumara Kurup case, that of Radhakrishnan in Kilimanur, Sri Budhan in Puyapalli, the visa agent Achan Kunju, Gracie, who belonged to Pala, Yohanan from Chengamanad, and the bank officer Soman. He also used a technique never used before, when, with a metal detector, he found a bullet in Chavakkad Johnny's dead body. The Sessions Court praised him for his efforts in this case. Dr. Umadathan's efforts helped the Kerala police, especially the crime branch to a certain extent, to regain the trust of the people. These memoirs are a mine of knowledge, and because Dr. Umadathan has such wide experience in his domain, the reader will end up learning the intricacies of forensic medicine. What is superimposition? How does a lie detector work? The importance of strands of hair and fiber in investigations? The principles of ballistics? The difference in the wounds that occur if someone is pushed down from a height, as opposed to when the person jumps down? All investigative officers must read this book. Dr. Umadathan gives a clear warning with clear examples that we must not be swayed by false complaints. He also gives examples of how different people react in different situations. In several chapters, he reminds us that a crime can never be hidden for a long time. Wine or women will end up losing tongues. Medical students, criminal lawyers, and forensic experts must read this book. A layperson can read it like a detective story. This is Dr. Umadathan's Oru Police Surgeonte Ormakkurippukal. Foreword by C.P. Nair, IAS Chief Secretary, retired, Thiruvananthapuram, 5th February 2010. A fruitful journey. Professor of Forensic Medicine, Police Surgeon, Medico-Legal Advisor to the Kerala Police, Principal of Trivandrum Medical College, Director of Medical Studies of the Government of Kerala, Medico-Legal Consultant to Libya, and a final appointment in a brilliant career as Professor and Head of the Forensic Medicine Department at the Amrita Institute of Medical Sciences, Kochi. For me, Umadathan was more than all this. He was one of my most brilliant students when I was a professor of English at Trivandrum University College between 1960-62. Our hero was then a good-looking young man, quite humble in demeanor and an excellent orator. The eldest son of Professor K. Balarama Panikkar, one of the best Sanskrit scholars Kerala has seen in the last century. He was also the son-in-law of my family doctor Mavelikara, K.C. Kunjaraman Vaidyar, an ace Ayurvedic practitioner. To me, he was like a younger brother, and I watched his career graph with pleasure and pride. He passionately wanted to pursue his studies in forensic medicine. It wasn't thrust upon him. He gained enviable knowledge of the subject and was successful in applying his theoretical knowledge to real-life situations. Driven by his insatiable curiosity, he never left his search for nuggets of knowledge. He said, "It has been 40 years since I started my romance with forensic medicine. Though I have retired, my romance still continues with intense passion. I choose to travel on a path that isn't preferred by most young doctors today. When I look back, I feel that my journey has been fruitful. I have never faltered in my quest for truth. I feel pride and contentment when I say this. His professional life was filled with startling incidents. To quote him once more, "The rich experience I have gained is through the lives that I have seen and the deaths, and the attempts to solve the mystery of those deaths that occurred under suspicious circumstances." I try here, in this memoir, to turn a few pages of the book of memory. Usually, such an autobiography need not necessarily be interesting to read. People who have read the heroic exploits of police officers would know this. But this one is a brilliant exception. A book of this sort might easily have become boring, but for the many factors that make it an interesting narrative, the first is his narrative style. Using short sentences, he manages to capture the rapt attention of his readers. As he learnt the basics of language from his father, who had deep knowledge in this area, he understood the covert structure of sentences. Such polish is rarely seen in the writings of professionals. He makes readers hold their breath while reading this suspense-filled narrative. He reveals the core of the story with the adeptness of a writer of detective fiction. It makes this book as exciting as a Sherlock Holmes mystery. Another aspect is the variety of cases described. Death in suspicious circumstances is how the police file a case, but each case is very different from the next. The writer sustains the suspense, and the ending of each case leads the reader to an unexpected climax. This adeptness in sustaining the curiosity of the reader is also evident in the titles he has given each chapter. His sense of humor and his imagination can be seen in the way he has structured each narrative. In the variety of themes in this book, one can also discern the different types of human behavior. Certain bad habits turn into perversions. We are shocked at the crimes committed due to greed and lust, which make human beings lose control over themselves. It is an old story that repeats itself, and most crimes are committed for gold or lust. We realize with a sense of shock that human nature is obscure and cruel. It goes without saying that it is not just the aesthetics that make this book commendable. Even from a professional perspective, it can be said that it is an authentic book in the area of forensic medicine. The first point is that Umadathan has been able to put across highly complex dimensions of a scientific discipline like forensic medicine in such a simple manner that even a person with no training in this area can understand the book. This is where most experts falter. There may be forensic experts who are as good as or even better than Umadathan, but they may not be able to narrate the nuances of their subject in such an accessible manner and in a way that lures the reader into the text. There are many tips in this narrative that can be used not only by forensic experts, but also by those who teach this subject in universities and students. It can be useful for lawyers who specialize in criminal cases. There are many case studies in this book that reveal how a forensic expert unravels a mystery that baffles investigators by basing his assumptions on logical analysis of scientific facts. The Soman case, the Sukumara Kurup case, the Polakkulam Pitambaran case, the Ramankari Soman case, the Muthuvara case, the Chavakar Johnny case, and the Professor Chacko case are just a few examples. Not just newcomers, but experienced hands must also note how carefully and diligently this doctor makes his assumptions. The dead tell stories, but to hear this, a forensic surgeon has to make sure that all his senses are alert. What better advice can be given? Like a teacher, he explains the techniques that he used to solve the cases that came his way. You just have to listen carefully. Ordinary people, too, can take away valuable lessons from this book. An example is chapter 2, where he describes various reasons why people commit suicide. A reader can learn a lot about ballistics, exhumation, and superimposition from this book. He is also aware of the limitations of scientific evidence. With great humility, he admits that luck is also an important factor in solving crimes. Solomon's Bees, a beautiful usage by Justice Katie Thomas, shows us that apart from professional expertise, coincidence also becomes an important factor in many cases. In many investigations, officers have to deal with the preconceived notions of the people in that particular area. A 17-year-old child dies under suspicious circumstances, and it has to be spiced up with sex. The suicide of young bridegroom has to be interpreted as murder. Why should a pretty servant in the house of a rich NRI jump into a pond and drown? Why did the sexy actress disappear? How did the dead body of a student reach the railway line? Doesn't the nude dead body of a young girl that was found near a resort tell the story of a brutal rape? The proliferation of electronic media increases the seriousness and complexity of this particular problem. People never bothered to think that it may not have been murder at all. If the investigation does not proceed along the lines that they want it to, people form action councils and agitate. They send mass petitions to everyone, from the panchayat members to the President of India. They also submit a writ in the High Court demanding that the Central Bureau of Investigation, CBI, take over the investigation. Only those with great confidence and composure can withstand these Talibanesque measures. Umadathan had to deal with such situations many times. And except in 2 cases, he withstood this sort of pressure in an unflappable manner. One who is on the side of justice need not fear that his reputation will be tarnished. Only in the Munna case and Abhaya case.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.